Welcome all, and as we prepare our hearts this Advent season, in the second Sunday of Advent, as we follow up on our theme for the season, Come, Lord Jesus. We welcome all of those who are worshiping with us online as well, and we pray, Come, Lord Jesus, with hope, hope in your promises. So let us begin with our Advent gathering song as printed. Of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, grant us forgiveness. Pray. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us, and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for all our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us join together in the prayer of the day for the second week of Advent. And we pray, stir up our hearts, O Lord, to prepare the way for your only Son. By his coming, give us strength in our conflicts and shed light on our path through the darkness of this world. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We turn to our Advent candle for the second week of Advent, the candle of John the Baptist. You may be seated. Tears are falling, hearts are breaking, how we need to from God. promised, we've been waiting. Welcome, Holy Child. Welcome, Holy Child. Fragile fingers sent to heal us, tender brow prepared for thorn. Tiny heart whose blood will save us, unto us is born. Unto us is born. We light the candle of John the Baptist, remembering Jesus, whom John proclaimed as the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. John prepared the way of the Lord into the hearts of the people. We remember Jesus, who came in answer to his people's prayers. He comes to us as we heed John's message. We hear his call to repent. We light two Advent candles as a sign of our repentance and desire for renewal. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. Through your word, may our souls be blessed. Amen. Turn to the Word of God for the second Sunday of Advent, and our Old Testament lesson is taken from Isaiah chapter 11. This is a wonderful prophecy of Jesus to come, and our theme for today is Come, Lord Jesus, with hope, especially as he comes to be the judge. And so we see him performing his future role as judge in these words as well. And yet in the midst of it all, he is there to work by the power of the Holy Spirit to bring us hope and life. We read, A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or decide by what he hears with his ears. But with righteousness he will judge the needy, with justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. In that day, the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for the peoples. The nations will rally to him, and his resting place will be glorious. This is the word of our Lord. Amen. Our gospel lesson is taken from the third chapter of Matthew, beginning with the first verse. This takes us to the ministry of John the Baptist, as he was the last Old Testament prophet, the final forerunner of the Savior to come, and he was preparing the hearts of people with a call to repentance and also the blessing of the waters of forgiveness in baptism. Let us rise to give honor to the very actions of John as he prepares the way for Jesus. In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, "A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." John's clothes were made of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. People went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not think you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me comes one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire." This is the word of our Lord. And let us confess our faith in the triune God with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for our sermon hymn, "Prepare the Royal Highway." It's one of our newer hymns, but the melody is easy to catch. It repeats quite often.
Prepare the royal highway.
God's word. God's people see him coming, your own eternal king. Palm branches strew before him, spread garments, shout and sing. God's promise will not fail you, no more shall God assail you. Hosanna to the Lord, for he fulfills God's word. Then fling the gates wide open to greet your promised king. Your king, yet every nation its tribute to should bring. All lands be bowed before him, all nations now adore him. Hosanna to the Lord, for he fulfills God's word. This is no earthly kingdom, it comes from heaven above. His rule is peace and freedom, and justice, truth, and love. So let your praise be sounding, for kind is so abounding. Hosanna to the Lord, for he fulfills God's word. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. The word of God for our message tonight is the epistle lesson. It's taken from Romans chapter 15. We begin at verse 4. Paul writes, "For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with one mind and one voice you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the Jews on behalf of God's truth, so that the promises made to the patriarchs might be confirmed, and moreover, that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, 'Therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles, I will sing the praises of your name.'" That's from the Psalms. Again it says, "Rejoice, you Gentiles, with his people." And that's from Moses. And again, "Praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Let all the peoples extol him." And all of the Lord's people extol him. And again, Isaiah says, "The root of Jesse will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations. In him, the Gentiles will hope." May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. And we pray, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, you probably know the following words from a classic Disney movie, "When You Wish Upon a Star." Makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you. And then again, if your heart is in your dream, no request is too extreme. When you wish upon a star, your dreams will come true. And that is a nice bit of Pinocchio paganism, if there ever was one, because it's obviously not something that's real or true. A star is not going to do anything in your life. It's not a god. And it's certainly not going to make every dream and wish come true. But the reason I mention this particular item is that it's very easy for us as people who are not believing in stars, not those earthly kind of stars anyway, to confuse wishing and hoping. So very often we use the word hope as if it's a wish, like wishing upon a star and you're going to get everything. We might say, I hope our family get together for Christmas will be great. I hope the airplane flights are not going to be canceled. I hope I don't ruin the Christmas dinner. I hope, children, that I get that expensive game outfit that I really would like. And maybe there's just a few of us here in Florida would say, I hope there would be a little snow on Christmas Eve. And so many of those things can vary from quite likely to very much impossible. I can't think of how many children's hearts are shattered when they don't get that expensive Christmas present that they really were hoping for. But you see, when we use the word hope, it's so very often a wish. We're wishing for something. And biblical hope is a whole lot different than that. Matter of fact, as we come to our theme, Come Lord Jesus, we want him to come with hope. And that's what this passage talks about over and over again, the hope that we have in the Lord. Now, what exactly is hope according to the Bible? It's not just a fond wish, like maybe something will happen if I pray enough and God will answer me. It's not a maybe. It's not an uncertainty. Hope is firm and certain and sure. It's going to happen. It just hasn't happened yet. And that's biblical hope. Biblical hope is a lot related to faith. For example, the Bible says that faith is the substance of things not seen. It's the confidence we have in things that we haven't seen. I have faith, I believe, that Jesus was born as a little baby from a virgin, and that he died for us on the cross and rose again from the dead to give us the victory. I haven't seen a bit of it, only in the movies that people have made up. I've seen it in scriptures, but I haven't seen it with my own eyes, and that's faith. Now, you could say that hope is faith for the future. We certainly haven't seen the future. And when God promises something, it's going to happen. We can be certain about it. We can have hope or faith for the future. That's how I would define biblical hope, faith for the future events. Faith over the fact that someday God will take us home to heaven and that Jesus has prepared a heavenly home. Faith and hope that he's going to watch over us and guide us through this life. Hope that come Lord Jesus and he is going to come in all of his glory, no doubt about it. And that is the kind of hope that we really need. Jesus is going to come in all glory, but even right now we want to say, come, Lord Jesus, with hope in your promises. Where does our hope come from? Our very first verse. For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. Not the first time we'll see, that's the first time, but not the last time we'll see that word hope. And what is all the rest all about? The things that were written in the past are the scriptures, aren't they? It's God's holy word, the holy scriptures, the things written about what happened in the past. And they were all written to teach us to have endurance and encouragement. So endurance is taught in the scriptures so that we might have hope. Encouragement is taught in the scriptures so that we might have hope. Endurance is a patient waiting on the Lord, a patient endurance or perseverance in the face of all the troubles and trials of this earth. We still hang on to God's promises, and the scripture shows us some fine examples of people being encouraged and endure even when the answers don't always come, they continue to hope. And that's a certain thing. Let's take Abraham, for example. God had promised him and Sarah a son. It wasn't happening, and it wasn't happening 25 years, and it was getting closer. And Sarah and Abraham had their times of doubt and wonder and so forth, but Abraham endured, and so did Sarah, although she had a little bit of a laughter problem, if you remember. And they endured, they persevered as they waited out God's promises. And that teaches us so very much when we are ready to give up on our hope and have doubts about what's going to happen and how God is going to work us out of this problem or that trial. We can take the encouragement and the endurance we see in scriptures to give us a renewal of our hope. And then what happened next? As we go down the line, God had promised Abraham that one of his descendants, one seed or offspring, through that one seed, all the world would be blessed, all nations of the world. And that didn't happen for quite a while. Abraham lived in 2000 BC approximately. We get all the way down to King David. And God promises King David that it's from his line, the line of Judah, the house of David, from which all the other kings would be coming after him, Solomon and so forth. And there would be one king that would sit on David's throne forever. Didn't happen soon in David's lifetime, 1000 BC. And 500 years later, David's line was just about decimated, wiped out entirely when the Babylonians destroyed Jerusalem, which was God's purpose because the people weren't listening. And so we hear about in Isaiah the root or stump of Jesse. We've got one of our banners that pictures the prophecy. And that prophecy was one that Isaiah wrote down. The root of Jesse will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations. In him, the Gentiles will hope. That's the last verse of our Isaiah reading. And Paul is quoting it directly. The root of Jesse, that family line was just about cut off, but there's going to be one branch from the roots that's still alive that will come about. And there was a couple, you know them as Mary and Joseph, who both descended from the line of David. And it was important for them to go to Bethlehem, not to claim royalty, because all they could claim was carpentry and motherhood. No, it was there to fulfill the census that Caesar wanted to take for the purpose of taxation. And so that little root of Jesse, who's Jesse? David's father, from Bethlehem. And David's father, his whole family tree was just about wiped out, except Jesus was born and he will arise to rule over the nations. In him, the Gentiles will put their hope. It's all wrapped up in Jesus, isn't it? That's where our hope is. That's where all of God's promises direct us to. He is fulfilling everything that we need so that we can hope on all of his other promises as well. Because it was fulfilled that Jesus arose after he died for us. And then he is now ruling over all the nations. And so people from everywhere, every nation around the planet, are putting their hope in him as Savior. And that's important for us because so very often we have our doubts. Even the most basic of hopes, will I really make it to heaven or not? and then you ponder some of the things that you've done wrong, or maybe there's some sin or other thing that really gnaws at you or has made problems in your family, and you start to think that maybe God doesn't care for me at all. He's going to judge me, and I have no hope. And it's a miserable life to live with hopelessness, isn't it? What future do we have if we don't have hope in Christ, and you're worried that he's going to come as judge, and he will? Where exactly will we stand in that whole judgment? Isaiah wrote in our reading, "He, Jesus, when he comes, will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears." In other words, he's not going to judge just by the outward appearance, what he sees with his eyes outwardly, or what people say and how they talk about how great and religious they are. That doesn't matter to him whatsoever. He knows the heart. With righteousness, complete rightness and justice, he will judge the needy, and will lift up the needy and the oppressed. And he also says, he will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Two choices when Jesus comes as judge. What is your hope? John the Baptist had the same kind of message, didn't he? He was preaching at the Jordan River, pointing people to the coming Messiah, and also assuring of them of the forgiveness of all their sins in the waters of holy baptism. And yet he also had to point out to some who are standing by, Jesus is coming, and his winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into his barn, and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire. He said that to all of the religious people that showed up, like the Pharisees and Sadducees. Jesus was going to be the harvester, and the winnowing fork, if you're not familiar with that, is the when you have gathered the wheat and harvested it from the field, you put it on the threshing floor and roll it all over, and you take the fork and throw it up in the air so that the chaff is blown away and the good seed falls to be gathered. And so Jesus is going to gather the good seed, all of us who believe in him and trust in him, and the chaff is going to be blown away and burned up in unquenchable fire. And have you ever said to yourself, I hope I'll be among the wheat? There's that wrong use of hope again. Because when there's any worries or doubts, suddenly we say, it was someone asked, are you going to go to heaven when you die? And you might say, oh, I hope so. And that's not a very confident answer, is it? But because of all that Jesus did, we have hope, the sure, certain kind, that he has really paid for all of our sins. And he will continue to guide us and bless us and encourage us. We can be certain when you say, I hope to go to heaven, that's no question mark in there whatsoever. If you're using the word biblically, you're saying, I know for sure that in the future God is going to take me home to our heavenly home. That's my hope. That's my certainty. That's my assurance. And so we have all of that, how through his promises and through his scriptures. And what does Paul write again? We need endurance and encouragement, but guess where we get it from? God, through the scriptures, through all of his promises. And he says, may God, who gives endurance and encouragement, give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had. God gives us the strength to overcome our doubts. And he gives us his encouragement, as he's doing right now through his word, to depend on the fact that Jesus has given us everything we need and overcomes all of our failures. And so that encouragement will give us the same attitude of mind that Christ Jesus had toward us. What attitude and mindset is he talking about? This sentence will it says in Philippians, what is the attitude of Christ? He made himself nothing, being made in human likeness, and he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And so that is our certainty, and that is the mindset of Jesus. He was willing to give all of heaven's glories up so that he might die in our place. And so that same self-attitude of humility and self-sacrifice for others is the mindset of Christ. And so that passage continues, God will give us the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, God is bringing us all together with the same faith, the same belief, the same mindset, so that we might glorify him for his wonderful salvation. And I can't think of a better time to do that than at Christmas time. God knows that our whole world is being divided up into little pieces, and it seems that everyone wants to divide things up by country and race and culture and language and split everyone apart and try to get them to hate each other, and by political persuasions. And all of those things can possibly ruin our country and ruin any peace of mind that people might ever want to have. But in Christ, we have the same mind. We, together with people and Christians around the world, are glorifying the God and Savior who has done it all for us. And so that's why I can't think of a better time to show that than at Christmas time. Throughout the world, you'll see Christmas trees. And this particular Christmas tree is in front of the Orthodox Church in the city of Nazareth. And it was January 19th of 2020 that I took that picture. There's an inside, and set in the tree is a nativity scene. And they're still celebrating Christmas into the last days of January. And then there's the tree in Bethlehem. About 5 days later, I took that particular picture. And so we see a very Muslim Palestinian city letting all the Christians gather in Bethlehem to celebrate the place where Jesus was born. And I can't think of a more unifying thing than Christmas. Down below the altar of the church there is this cave that has been kind of remodeled to have flat walls. And supposedly within this cave, that was where Jesus was born. And what looks like a fireplace is actually this. It's a 17-pointed star that supposedly marks the exact place where Mary gave birth to Jesus. I have doubts about that, but it certainly has close proximity. And one voice, all nations glorifying God together. People lined up to come down these steps, and then they would leave out through those steps underneath the altar. And we were standing back for a little while just watching some of the crowds, and I heard not only Away in the Manger in English, but Spanish and Korean, and people singing the same tune to honor Jesus from all nations of this earth. And what a privilege we have to share that true hope at Christmas time. We have something that can be, that supersedes all cultures in knowing that God has provided a certain hope of our salvation in the little baby that was born for us and did everything else for us. So Paul concludes, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Yes, he's the God of hope. He solidifies our faith for the future. And I can't think of a better time than right now to show that joy and peace throughout all of the world. We sing about all those things, hope and joy and peace. God rest you, merry gentlemen. Let nothing you dismay, for Jesus Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day. Yeah, that's the tidings of joy and peace. Tidings of comfort and joy. May God give you peaceful rest, is what that little carol means. And when you have that peace and joy in Christ Jesus, it can overflow, just like you take a cup and forget about stopping to pour. It overflows all over the place. And that's what we want to do at Christmas time. You know someone, perhaps, who is without hope, right near hopelessness. And the holidays can provoke that because some things are not going to happen exactly the way they used to, and people often will have a time of despair during the middle of the holidays. But our hope, our peace in Christ, our joy that He came into the world can overflow to those who really need it. I can't think of a better time than, let's say, Christmas Eve to invite someone who is uncertain and hopeless to come and hear the great news of joy. And actually, you can do that any Sunday or Saturday night as well. And there may be some who would not dare to walk into a church, but your peace and joy in the hope of Christ can overflow outside of these walls. It needs to. In the things that you say at Christmas time, the blessings that you pass on to other people, the greetings that you have, the letters or cards that you might send, or now more, it's more texts and emails, I know. But whatever way we can reach out our true hope to all the world around us, that is our goal at this Advent time. So, are you going to wish upon a star? I don't know how much good that will do, but I'd like to change that just a little bit. When you hope in Jesus Christ, makes no difference who you are. That's the Gentiles, all nations. Makes no difference who you are. The joy and peace your heart desires will come to you. If your heart is in the Lord, His holy world will see you through. When you hope in Jesus Christ, His promises come true. That's hope. Amen. Let us rise. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us respond by singing this song of praise.
What they love.
We turn to the Lord in prayer that he might continue to guide us and strengthen us in our hope and prepare us for the Advent season. I also have one special prayer I'd like to offer for Peter Gray, the husband of Mary Kay, who's with us tonight. And they just found out this week that he will need open heart surgery, which will happen on Wednesday. So we'd like to keep Peter in prayer. I also want to say a prayer of thanks for Al Salinitro. We've been praying for him and found out it's just arthritis. I know arthritis is painful, but it's certainly not cancer. And so he's been declared free of any of those kinds of worries and will be dealing with the pain problem. We pray. O Holy Redeemer, Prince of Peace, though you appeared here in lowliness to free us from our sins and to establish peace between us and our God, we have your promise that you will come again in great power to judge all hearts and fill your church with eternal glory. We await your advent with eagerness and joy. Come, Lord Jesus, and then come right now to us with hope in your promises. Help us to be prepared at all times for your coming. Keep our hearts filled with true contrition and faith. Overcome our doubts. Cast sin from our lives. Keep us from embracing the treasures and sinful pleasures offered by the world. And fill us with humility that we may never trust our own works to merit heaven, but rely fully on you to save us. So, Lord Jesus, with the hope, bright hope of your coming, cast the dark shadows of sorrows and cares from our hearts. Let that hope overflow in our lives. Especially we ask for those that it might overflow to those who are still in darkness or are going through very serious troubles and trials and sicknesses. They weigh us all down, Lord, believers and unbelievers alike. Continue to help us to share the good news of great joy that you came into this world to be our Savior. So we give you thanks that you heard our prayers for Al Salinitro and you're guiding things well through the doctor's tests and ask that you would provide proper treatment and relieve him of some of his pains. And now we pray especially for Peter Gray. Take away all the worries and anxieties that come because of a major surgery. Guide the surgeon and all who attends him on the surgery on Wednesday. Be with him, bless him, help him, and provide healing and recovery in a quick fashion. We pray all these things as we look to you for everything we have for life and for all eternity. Amen. And then we continue with the sung version of the Lord's Prayer. Blessing of God's name. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. Please be seated for our closing hymn. In the manger, infant of Mary, outcast and stranger, Lord of us all. Child who inherits all our transgressions, all our demerits upon him fall. Once the most holy child of salvation, gently and lowly lived here below. Now as our glorious, mighty Redeemer, see him victorious over each foe. Foretold yet, infant of wonder, angels behold him on his throne. Worthy our Savior of all their praises, happy forever are his own. Good evening. Welcome all as we gather together for our worship tonight. I want to say a special thanks to Sandra Burke and others, but especially Sandy gathered together. We had about 20 ladies this afternoon, I think, that gathered together for the Christmas tea. So that was a wonderful and joyous occasion as well. And we will continue in our preparing the way of the Lord Jesus for Christmastide. This coming Wednesday will be our in-person Advent special service. So that's happening at 7 o'clock. It's called An Evening with Isaiah, and various members are going to be singing or reading the portions of the message. So I still could use a couple more volunteers if someone would like to volunteer to be a reader. And we'll also, for those of you online, we'll try to stream it on Facebook like we did for Thanksgiving. May not be a perfect recording, but at least it's better than not having it at all. So we will do that on Wednesday night. And then next Sunday, we continue with Come, Lord Jesus, come with patience in times of suffering. And that comes from the readings that are appointed for the third Sunday of Advent. So may the Lord bless us all. By the way, if anyone is interested, we will be decorating the church and putting up the trees and everything right after the worship service tomorrow, Sunday, at about 11:45. Thank you all.